the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
A very warm welcome to our service this morning. And our theme for this morning is Journeying with Christ. And we're going to be looking especially at the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Rachel will be providing a special item for our youngsters later on in the service. And we also have a special appearance from some friends from Uplifted. So we've got that to look forward to. But we start our worship this morning with a gathering prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this new day. We thank you for your love, which draws us into your presence. We pray that you may be with us this morning as we gather to meet you from wherever we have journeyed. May you open our hearts and minds to hear and receive your word and refresh us again by the power of your Spirit to become more like the people you call us to be. Amen. And now let's just bow our heads and pray together. We call to mind our sin, our failure to value the love of others, and our failure to love as Christ has loved us. Your love gives us life from the moment of conception, yet we fail to live as your children. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You call us to do good, yet we seek our own good. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. You hear us when we cry for help, yet we ignore the cries of others. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by God's Spirit, and raise us to new life. In Jesus our Lord. Amen. And our collect prayer for the fourth Sunday of Easter. Merciful Father, you gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the Good Shepherd, and in his love for us, to lay down his life and rise again. Give us always his protection, and give us grace to follow in his steps, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now Mr. Fidler will read for us our first Bible reading.
This reading is taken from Acts, chapter 4, verses 5 to 12. The next day, their rulers, elders and scribes assembled in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John and Alexander, and all who were the high priestly family. When they had made their prisoners stand in the midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick, and are asked how this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders. It has become the cornerstone. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among mortals by which we must be saved."
Thank you, Mr. Fidler. And now we sing together our first hymn, The King of Love.
Thank you.
And now Rachel will read for us our gospel reading from a children's friendly version of the Bible. And the reading is taken from Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35.
Hello, everyone. I hope you had a lovely Easter and lots to celebrate and enjoyed lots of chocolate. I'm going to read the story for the children's version on Road to Emmaus, which is what we've been discussing in, well, Wendy has, in the service today. So, two friends on the road. And it's taken from God's story. Now, there was a little town called Emmaus. It was about 7 miles away from Jerusalem. Two of Jesus' friends were walking to Emmaus. They were talking about the bad things that had happened to Jesus, and they were feeling rather sad. While they were talking, Jesus came up to them. He began to talk to them, but they were kept from knowing who he was. "What are you talking about?" asked Jesus. The two friends stopped walking. They stood still. Their faces were very sad. One was Cleopas. "Are you the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard?" he asked. "Don't you know what's happened there?" "What?" asked Jesus. Now, bear in mind, children, they didn't know that this was Jesus, for somehow he was kept from the sight of these two friends. "It's about Jesus," they said. "He was a prophet. What he said was powerful. What he did was powerful, but our leaders at the worship house had killed him. They crucified him. We hoped he would save our nation." "Now, 2 days have passed," they said. "It's the third day since this happened." Women from our group told us something really surprising. Early this morning, they went to the tomb, but Jesus' body wasn't there. The women said they saw angels, these big, bright angels, told that Jesus was alive. Then some men from our group went to the tomb. They said it was just as the women had said. They didn't see Jesus. "You have a lot to learn," said Jesus. "It takes you a while to believe what the prophet said. Didn't the promised one have to go through these things?" Then Jesus began telling them about Moses and the prophets. He made it all very clear. He told them what God's word said about himself. They came to the town where they were going, Emmaus. And Jesus acted as if he would go on from there. "Stay with us," said the two followers. "The day is almost over." So, what do you think Jesus did, children? Yes. So Jesus went to stay with them because it was late and probably hungry at the time. When they sat down to eat, Jesus picked up the bread. He thanked God for it. Then he started giving it to his friends. That's when they were able to see it was Jesus. Oh, suddenly, Jesus was then gone. The two followers looked at each other. Wasn't it wonderful when he talked on the road? It was Jesus. And they started to reflect on their journey. It was wonderful when he told us what God's word meant. And they soon realised what it all meant. They got up and they hurried back to Jerusalem. So that's just a short story. I mean, there's lots of children's Bible stories out there that, you know, just make it a little bit simpler for your children to understand and enjoy. So that's my part.
Thank you, Rachel. A few years ago, I, along with 5 other work colleagues, decided to embark on a journey. A journey of around 19 miles, aptly named the Coniston Challenge. This was a fundraising event and it had sponsored teams competing against each other in aid of guide dogs for the blind. The challenge was made up of a 13-mile bike ride up a mountain path, followed immediately by a 2-mile row across Coniston Lake, and finishing with a climb of around 4 miles up Old Man Coniston himself. The morning of the event found our team in good spirits. the sudden appearance of the sun after a night of torrential rain added to our feelings of enthusiasm and confidence. We'd trained hard and we were itching to get started. We lined up at the starting point, astride our bikes, and waited for the marshal to count us down. The time came. 3, 2, 1. We were off, straight out of the field, up the road and away, pedalling furiously in completely the wrong direction. We totally failed to see both the arrow pointing the right way up the road and the mountain we were meant to be heading towards. We'd been so tied up in our own thoughts that we'd failed to notice all the obvious directions. Luke's account this morning tells us of two disciples on their own journey. Their destination is a village called Emmaus, a distance of around 7 miles out of Jerusalem. It's the third day after Jesus' death, and these travellers are very preoccupied. They certainly have plenty to think about. One of the walkers is a man named Cleopas, and though we don't know for sure, he may well be the Cleopas referred to in John 19, the husband of Mary, who was present at the crucifixion. If this is the case, then the walkers could well have been husband and wife. Deep in conversation, they walk on, away from the town, downcast, probably frightened and confused. For them, the events of the last few days have been devastating. It's all too much to take in. So they head off on their own, away from the place where all the bad stuff took place, away from the place where 11 disciples, together with others, are all gathered, away from the possibility of any encouragement or comfort from fellow believers. I wonder, how do we react when we face problems? What's our first response when we have a challenge? If we have a personal problem or something maybe on a wider scale, do we turn to each other, to our fellow believers, for strength, insight, wisdom? Or do we bury our heads in the sand? Do we feel we should go it alone? When things get bad, where do we turn for direction? I'll leave you with that thought for a moment, and we're going to hand over to Rachel, who something has a little item for our children.
I'm just going to show you some short crafts that you can do at home together to reflect on this story. So, I did these at home the other night. Now, these are my feet. And yours are going to be a lot smaller unless they're your mummies and daddies. So you can get some feet, paint your feet, get really messy, not on the carpet. So get really messy, paint your feet, and you can walk along a sheet of paper or a card like this. You can do a little heart and walk with Jesus, like the road to Emmaus. You know, have that belief and rest around you. Or you could draw around your feet, which will be less messy, which some parents might prefer. You could draw around your feet like this, another one on my trotters, and have it like a flip-flop. So all I've done here is use a pipe cleaner, poke 3 holes, 1, 2, 3, and then just literally, I'll show you for those at home, I've literally just kind of threaded the pipe cleaner through. So at the back there, I've pushed it through. I've pushed it through at the top up here and back from to the front again, and then I've popped it back down here, and then you've got like the flip-flop kind of idea. Walk with Jesus. I have another idea. These probably for the smaller children, but for the older children they might like to have a go at this. You could do a bit of a role play with a story at home with your families. I spent quite a bit of time doing some colouring the other night. So all I did, now these you can get from Baker Ross, you can get from Hobbycraft. eBay's great for looking for arts and crafts that are cheap. So that's all I did, and then got some Sharpie markers and just coloured in Jesus and the two disciples. Can you see that there? And then just got a paper plate, so that's my road. And I've just imagined what it probably would look like where they are, and you could do a little role play with a story and go, I've just put a slit through there with a pair of scissors. So the children might like to do a bit of role play and have a bit of fun with that with the story. You can make up conversations, children, or they can ask questions. The two friends could talk together and think, you know, what were they thinking at the time? You know, were they sad? And then all of a sudden, what were they thinking when they realised it was Jesus? So all these lovely little questions you can ask each other and reflect on the story and have fun. And the main thing is have fun when you're learning and exploring the Bible and your faith journey. Now take care, have a lovely weekend, and I'll see you all soon. Bye.
The next stage of my Coniston challenge was the rowing event. Now this was the bit I was seriously worried about. As someone with a bit of a dodgy back, I didn't know how I would stand rowing across the lake in a two-man kayak. One of my teammates, an Irish vet named David, offered to do the rowing for me so I could save myself for the rest of the challenge. Off we went, out onto the very dark, deep waters of Coniston Lake. We were right out in the middle of the lake when David, muscles not quite recovered from the bike ride, suddenly had an attack of the most excruciatingly painful bout of cramp. Writhing around in an attempt to bring himself some relief, the inevitable happened. He fell in. Now, I'm ashamed to say, my first thought was not to jump in after him to save him, but it was to give it a moment and see if the life jacket worked. Luckily, it did. And he soon shot up out of the water. When we eventually got him back into the boat, it was left for me to row us both back to shore. He hadn't been my hero after all. Jesus, unrecognised by the walkers, comes alongside and asks them what they're talking about. They give a resume of the events of the last few days of Jesus' life. No doubt they're frightened, confused, and exhausted, but there's something else they are too. They're disappointed. They're disappointed in Jesus. He hadn't been the hero they thought he might be. They say, we had hoped that he was the one who would redeem Israel. We had hoped. Jesus had failed their expectations. They must have heard, if not witnessed for themselves, the healings, the miracles. They would have regarded Jesus as not just a man, but as God's man. And God's man had gone and let himself be killed, murdered by a regime they thought he'd come to save them from. The dream was over. He had failed. The problem was that they were expecting a different kind of hero to solve Israel's problems. They knew their scriptures, and they'd been promised a redeemer, one who would defeat the oppressors of the Israel nation and lead them to freedom, the new Exodus. Convinced by their own understanding of the scriptures, they had totally missed the relevance of the greatest event in history, an event that they'd been watching and waiting for. The problem was, Jesus didn't fit the bill. He wasn't the kind of saviour they thought they needed. Before Cleopas and his companion could understand the significance of what had just happened, they had to reach a better understanding. Along with everyone else in Israel, they'd got hold of the wrong end of the stick. How often today do we hear the name of Jesus being used to promote a particular agenda? How many people are put off from even looking at the Christian faith because they feel that those promoting it are pushing politics that they don't themselves share? Of course, our Christian views should shape the way we see the world, and that may inevitably involve politics. But our personal political views should never be a stumbling block for others in their seeking out the Lord. And so Jesus comes alongside them. He walks with them, and using all the scriptures, he opens their eyes to the truth. Now, Luke could have pointed out here scriptures of particular relevance, ones that go from Genesis onwards, referring to specific points in Christ's life. But he doesn't do that. It's bigger than that. The whole of the New Testament points us to how God would redeem his world through his anointed one. The bit everyone had failed to understand was that God would not redeem his people from suffering. He would redeem them through his own suffering. And as they look again at the scriptures, this time with open minds and with Jesus as their guide, they see a different picture. They see the big picture. The story of Jesus, the Redeemer, is woven through the scriptures like a cord stretching from Genesis through the Old Testament. And what an encouragement that should be for us to pursue our struggle in our understanding of both the New and the Old Testament scriptures. And more than that, to be prepared to look afresh at our long-standing, long-held assumptions, to take the risk of letting Jesus challenge us with new insights, even when they threaten our comfortable understandings. If we're not prepared to do this, how will we ever feel our hearts burning within us as Jesus leads us deeper into our relationship with him? Just like our Emmaus travellers, to do this successfully, we need Jesus' help. And all Bible study should be accompanied by prayer. Prayer and expectation. We should ask Jesus to accompany us, to accompany our studies, and be prepared for him to surprise us along the way. So Jesus opens the scriptures to the two travellers, but they still don't recognise who he is. And this failure seems to be a feature of the resurrection accounts. We read in Matthew and John that those first seen Jesus after his crucifixion also failed to recognise him. Luke puts it more strongly. He says they were kept from recognising him. Maybe they were kept from recognising Jesus by divine intervention. Maybe his resurrection appearance was somehow different. Or maybe they were kept from recognising Jesus by their own blindness to accept who he really was and how he fitted in to God's plan for saving his world. Let's leave it there for a minute and hand over to Uplifted.
Electrify. It lifts me up.
Thank you, Uplifted. And so to the last part of the Coniston Challenge, the walk up the mountain. Tired, but spurred on by completing the two previous tasks, we march onwards. We know we're on the homeward stretch. Besides, we've come a long way together. We're with companions we can trust. We have a few hiccups along the way, the odd blister, and a moment when one of us wants to give up altogether. But we know deep down we'll see it through. After all, somewhere at the bottom of this mountain is a reception building, the place where all our friends are waiting to share a meal and welcome us home. The disciples reach their destination. They arrive in Emmaus. Jesus appears to be going onwards, but the disciples urge him to stay. He doesn't force his presence on them. It must be at their request. Equally, Jesus lets them provide him with hospitality. He's generous enough to allow them to be charitable. And so he enters and shares with them a meal. In fact, the first meal of the new order. He gives thanks and he shares the bread. And it's at this moment that they recognise at last who he is. They weren't there at the Last Supper to hear the words Jesus used, but they've almost certainly seen him break bread in this way many times before. And it's in this act, which goes going forward is to be a symbol of God's people, that at last they recognise Jesus for who he is. Knowledge of the scriptures, important as it is not enough. Knowledge and relationship with Jesus leads them to declare for themselves, it is true, the Lord has risen. And what's the first thing they do at this discovery? The scripture says, they got up and returned at once, heading back to where they'd come from, ready to give their testimony to those who believed and to those who were still unsure. Back home to Jerusalem, this time heading in the right direction. And now we sing our second hymn, the words of which reflect our journey with Christ. One more step along the world I go.
Thank you.
And now Rachel and Laura will lead us in our prayers.
Dear God, you put the warmth of Jesus in our hearts. Let us celebrate that Jesus is always with us, even when we don't realise it. Amen. So just go back on to the arts and crafts I did earlier. I found this lovely footprint on the internet, and it's a lovely poem, and it really kind of reflects and complements the story that I've just been talking about. So I'm going to read it to you, and you can print it off at home, put it on your wall in your bedroom if you want to, if you like it, obviously. So I'm going to read this lovely poem for you all. So the Lord will always walk with you along life's blessed beach. His footprints there beside your own, always within reach. Two sets of footprints side by side, from dawn to setting sun. Yet there may come a day, my child, when you'll see only one. But do not think the Lord has left you. Nothing could be more wrong. It's just that he has picked you up to carry you along.
Walk with us, Lord, as we step out into each new day, into the beautiful world that you have created. Help us to see you in every flower, to hear your voice in the whisper of the wind, to glimpse your glory in the beauty of a sunset. Walk with us, Lord, every step of the way. Walk with us, Lord, when we stray from the path, when we forget about you in the busyness of our lives, when our own needs and wants are all that we see, and the way is obstructed by our selfish desires. Walk with us, Lord, every step of the way. Walk with us, Lord, as we stroll through the world, through the fields and the cities, over sea, all around. Help us to see you in those that we meet, to shine with your love. Walk with us, Lord, every step of the way. Walk with us, Lord, through our times of suffering and pain. Help us to trust you in the darkest of times. Use us, Father, to bring hope and comfort to all those around us who are in need and frail. Walk with us, Lord, every step of the way. Walk with us, Lord, on our journey of faith. Show us the truths you long for us to understand. Keep bringing us back when we stray from your side. Be with us always, our guide and our friend. Amen.
And now we will bring all our prayers together by saying together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. It just remains now for me to remind you to join us next week, when Margaret will be leading our service, the theme for which is God is Love. Looking further ahead, we're going to have an outdoor service at 8 p.m. on Ascension Day on Thursday, the 13th of May. And it will be held in the churchyard at the south side. Everybody's welcome. But let's finish our service now with a blessing. The love of the Lord Jesus Christ draw us to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us in his service, and the joy of the Lord Jesus Christ fill our hearts, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen.